Okay, let's go back to processor B, which is consuming power P and time T. And to be more concrete, let's assume that this is a processor that consumes 100 watts of power and finishes a task in 100 seconds. So this is the P and this is the time taken. Okay, what dynamic frequency scaling does is, you know, at runtime, depending on needs, it can scale the frequency up or down. Okay, so ultimately what it's saying is, you know, I can increase my frequency or I can reduce my frequency, and that will have some impact on both power and time. Okay, so we said that, you know, this power can be split up as 75 watts of dynamic power and 25 watts of leakage power. Okay, let's say that my initial frequency was 1 gigahertz, that is a cycle time of 1 nanosecond. Let's say that I halve my frequency. So my new frequency is 0.5 gigahertz. Right? This means my cycle time has gone from 1 nanosecond to 2 nanoseconds. Okay, so this cycle time was 1 nanosecond. This new cycle time is 2 nanoseconds. And you know what this means is the pipeline will still work correctly because each of the circuits has been designed to complete within 1 nanosecond. And now the next clock edge is showing up after 2 nanoseconds. Okay, that means, you know, each of my circuits has enough time to finish the task that has been assigned to it. Okay, so there should be no correctness issue. On the other hand, if I try to increase frequency, then my circuits perhaps may not work. Okay, so increasing frequency is usually not an option. Okay, so all I can do is try to reduce frequency, and let's see how that impacts both power and time. Okay, so the dynamic component, as I said, is a linear function of frequency, right? So we had said that the dynamic power is linearly proportional to V square F. I'm not changing voltage over here, I'm just changing F. So the new dynamic power is going to become, you know, half of 75 watts, so it's going to become 37.5 watts. And the leakage power is going to remain exactly the same, because if you recall, leakage power is a function of, you know, the number of transistors, the supply voltage, and the leakage current. Okay, and we're not affecting any of those by changing frequency. Okay, so leakage remains the same, and it starts to dominate the overall power consumption. Okay, so the new power is going to be 62.5 watts. Okay, now meanwhile, time is also going to change, right? If you've changed the frequency, the program's IPC may be impacted and the program's frequency is being impacted, which means it, you know, it'll likely take longer to finish the same program. Okay, you know, one naive way to look at it is to say that IPC will remain the same, and since the frequency has halved, the time will now become 200 seconds. Okay, so if I made that assumption, my new energy will be 62.5 times 200, which is actually, you know, 1.25 times my old energy. Okay, so with dynamic frequency scaling, I have doubled my execution time, and I've not quite halved my power consumption because of this leakage component, which is unaffected. Okay, so in terms of energy, dynamic frequency scaling seems to be a pretty bad idea. Okay, but in terms of power consumption, it can be pretty effective. It can allow a given processor to work correctly with a given cooling solution. Okay, now there's one minor caveat over here. So I assume that, you know, this program is entirely CPU bound. That is, its behavior is entirely determined by how fast the clock is running. And so if I halve the clock speed, it takes twice as long to finish. Okay, but most programs, you know, this is your CPU, and there's also an external memory that is connected to it. When you change the frequency, you're only impacting the CPU. You're keeping the memory at its same speed. Okay, so if getting something from memory took 100 nanoseconds, then in my old processor, this memory access corresponded to 100 cycles. And in my new processor, that memory access corresponds to only 50 cycles. So when you go to a lower CPU frequency, the memory access in terms of cycles actually becomes less. So every time there's a memory access, you're penalizing yourself less in terms of cycles. Okay, so in the new design, the CPI actually decreases, or the IPC increases. Okay, so when you halve the frequency, the effect is not that your performance goes down by a factor of 2. It goes down by a factor which is a little less than 2. Okay, so you know, because your memory access has not become any slower, your overall performance is not going to quite double, and so instead of 200 seconds, this might actually be 175 seconds. Okay, and the only way to figure that out is to run your program and see exactly how memory bound it is. The more memory bound it is, the less it is going to be impacted by a change in the CPU frequency. Okay, so now if I replace, so you know, if I multiply this by, you know, 0.875, that is 175 by 200, then the new energy is not going to be as bad, but it's still, you know, at least based on this calculation, it'll still be a little bit higher than old E. Okay, so you know, based on some performance simulation, you have to figure out if this does indeed yield less energy or not. Okay, but in general, it seems that just changing the frequency can really help reduce power consumption, but it does not have a huge impact on energy consumption because you are kind of offsetting a linear impact on dynamic power with a linear increase, a possibly linear increase in execution time. Okay, so now let's talk about dynamic voltage and frequency scaling. Okay, so now if, you know, let's say my supply voltage is 1 volt. If I make my new supply voltage equal to 0.9 volts, what impact does that have? Okay, so now, you know, if I have a given circuit in my pipeline, which finishes in 1 nanosecond at 1 volt, that same circuit, if you operate it at 0.9 volts, is going to take a little bit longer because circuit delays are inversely proportional to voltage. So this circuit is now going to take roughly 1.1 nanoseconds to finish. Okay, which means if I provide the clock here and then I provide the clock at 1 nanosecond, this circuit is not going to work correctly. Okay, because by the time the clock edge is received, the circuits have not quite finished their work and you might be latching an incorrect result. Okay, so for this circuit to work correctly, the clock edge has to come at this point after 1.1 nanoseconds. Okay, so if you change voltage, you have to also change your frequency. Okay, so if you reduce voltage, you have to increase your cycle time. That means you have to reduce your frequency as well. Okay, so if the new supply voltage is 0.9, the new frequency also has to be 0.9 gigahertz. All right, so let's see how this impacts power consumption. All right, so we started out with 100 watts over here, which was 75 watts dynamic and 25 watts leakage. Okay, this 75 watts is a function of V square F. So the new dynamic power would be 75 times 0.9 times 0.9 square, right? So this is the V part and this is the F part. Okay, and this works out to something in the neighborhood of 56 watts, I believe. And then the 25 watts is the leakage power, which is a linear function of supply voltage. So since this has gone down from 1 to 0.9 volts, this will go down to 22.5 watts. So 25 times 0.9. Okay, so the net power consumption is, I believe, well, I think this is close to 55. And so this works out to about 77 watts. Okay, so by reducing voltage by about 10%, I'm causing about a 23% drop in overall power consumption, right? So there's a huge compounding effect over here because your dynamic power is a function of V square F. So a small change in V results in a small change in F, which gets magnified because of the V square F effect and causes a huge reduction in overall power consumption. Okay, let's look at energy, right? So since the frequency has gone down to 0.9, this program, which took 100 seconds before, is now going to take about 110 seconds. Okay, maybe a little bit more than that. Again, this is assuming that my program is entirely CPU bound. If it was not CPU bound, and if, you know, there were parts of it that were accessing memory, which is now relatively faster, then it won't be slowed down by as much as 10%. It might be slowed down to, say, you know, 108 seconds. Okay, so the new energy would be the new power, 77 watts times the time, 108, okay, which is roughly in the neighborhood of about, you know, 0.83, 0.84 times old energy. Okay, so this is a great way to reduce my overall energy, right? So previously I said that DFS does not have a huge impact on energy. In fact, it increases overall energy. Whereas when I apply DVFS, it causes a huge drop in power consumption. It does not hurt performance as much because it's only having a linear effect on performance, whereas it's having a more than quadratic effect on power consumption. Okay, so the net effect is that DVFS causes a huge drop in energy consumption as well. Okay, so if I apply DVFS to my processor, so if I take processor B and I apply DVFS to it, I just showed you that I can come down to as low as 0.84 of the old energy, which is exactly where processor A is at. Okay, now of course processor A can also employ DVFS to bring down its energy consumption even more. Okay, so if you're really comparing energy, you should look at the lowest operating voltage for A and B and compute how much energy is being consumed at that point. Okay, so you know, just looking at power times T may not tell you the lowest energy possible for a given program. Okay, and you know, often what is perhaps a better indicator is a metric like energy delay or energy delay square. Okay, but ultimately there is no substitute to looking at the lowest operating voltage for each processor and estimating the energy that it takes to finish a given task at that operating energy. Having had this discussion about power and energy, we will now move on to hardware intensive techniques, starting with the next video.